The next topic will be about brands. All brands fight an uphill battle, how to deal with all these new disruptors, all these new little companies from young people who are very digital and really eating up all their business. How do people react to that? How do these small companies engage with that? What are they doing? That will be the next topic of our next panel. I'm looking really forward, ladies and gentlemen. Please welcome one of the heroes of Berlin. Please welcome Mirko Caspar, the managing director of Mr. Spex. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome David Roberts, co-founder of FlareAudio. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome a very special girl. She was the only girl actually known this side of the Mississippi who did cook with Mr. Tim Cook. Please welcome Verena Hubertz, CEO and co-founder of Kitchen Stories. And ladies and gentlemen, the host of this very next panel is the one and only. Please give him a very, very big hand. Please welcome Adam Singoda. It's all yours.
Wow. That's the first time it ever happened to you, admit it. A round of applause for our band. So, I think it's a special panel, not only because I moderate it, but I'll tell you why. Well, these are very special people that run very special companies. You see, for two main reasons, in my opinion. One, they found a way to do something digitally in a big way that most human beings used to do it in the physical world. They do it in a digital world. And the second thing that's really special about these guys and girls is that they're fighting big brands. And what's better than beating a big brand? So I think from my perspective, you know, if we can come out of this panel today with some learnings about what's a good way to fight a big company that everybody's know, you know, they know them, they use them, and to find a different way to do it, because there's a traditional way and there's the new way you have to come up when you do it. That's the first thing. And the second thing, if we can find some, you know, if we have time towards the end, some advice about culture and how to run a company and where you'll be in 10 years. And if we get to the soft stuff towards the end, that would be great. So to kick it off, why don't you spend a minute to just introduce yourself and your companies? Verena, yeah.
Yes, hi, my name is Verena. I'm one of the two founders of Kitchen Stories. Who knows to cook? Well, that's good. I didn't know how to cook, so I started Kitchen Stories because I was always lost online. I was always lost when it said dice it up, do X, do whatever. So we said we want to do a mobile application and we want to make anyone cook. So we have videos, we have step-by-step photos, and we are global. We are in more than 150 countries and trying to change the world of cooking with a premium product and hopefully a really loved brand.
Super. I'm Mirko from Mr. Spex. I'm one of two co-CEOs. Mr. Spex is the largest online optician in Europe. Basically, when we started roughly 10 years ago, glasses were sold by an optician who told you, oh my God, it's terrible. Your eye condition is terrible. And then you ended with a very, very, your customer journey with a very, very high-priced product that you thought you needed. And basically we said, you know, we can use the internet to make this a bit more transparent, to give you much more choice 24/7, all the stuff that the internet brings, but the eyewear industry didn't offer. And by now, actually, we also have 600 partner opticians to offer all types of services that you have to have, like an eye test or a fitting offline in Europe. And we also have 10 own stores by now. And I think even the offline stores we do fundamentally different than the traditional industry.
I'm Davies Roberts, CEO and founder of FlareAudio. About 7 years ago, I was providing sound systems for major artists and touring bands and became very aware that concerts sounded really, really bad and muffled. They sounded a bit like this. And I started looking into why and realized that the teachings of acoustics over the last 100 years have been wrong. They've been treating loudspeakers like acoustic instruments. So I developed a total of 12 patents that now enable us to create mirror image sound so that when you plug our earphones in, it sounds like you've plugged into the electronics of the sound. It's incredibly disruptive. We started off in the pro audio industry, but that meant that the small industry that it was tried to keep us out of the industry. So we moved into consumer and started an ear protector. Last year, that ear protector rocketed, selling 250,000 units, 5.9 million turnover. And we're using digital means to educate people on our technology and to grow the brand and to challenge the main brands such as Beats, Bose, Bowers & Wilkins, etc.
All right. So the first question is around fighting big brands. So I want to ask the audience a question by a raise of hand. Who in the last 12 months purchased a product that's either glasses, any type of glasses, or a headphone, or a cooking book? So think Martha Stewart, Bose, Armani. 12 months. Maybe 50% of you. So, question to you, how do you fight that? How do you fight, you know, all of the 50% of the people here have purchased one of your products or something in your space, and they bought it from someone that they know. It's a brand their parents knew, they grew up on that brand, they're seeing big commercials for that brand, it's in the paper. How do you fight a big brand? Any one of you?
Through communication. In the old days when big brands existed before the digital realm, you had to spend huge amounts of many seven figures creating brand awareness through billboards, through print media, etc. But that's pretty much all just throwing money away. So for us, we form our message on social and on digital channels, and we educate people. The more connected the world gets through the internet, through websites, through social, the more disruptive the world will be, because disruption is ideas. Ideas are improving what's already done. So disruption is completely natural process once you become closer together.
So but Davies, nobody knows, so day one, nobody knows your company. I need to buy you or buy Beats. Beats is Dr. Dre, you're not. So how do, why do I buy you?
Through clear messaging, through very thought out things about what we say, being very clear, explaining our advantage over our competitors and our technology. We work really hard to do everything that we say is very clear. That's one of the problems when you come along and you're disruptive and the market's been completely promised the next big thing and it hasn't happened. The sound industry has been promised the high quality, high quality, high quality, and it never has been high quality because of the devices. So we're selling a real quality product into a very saturated, very confused, very, you know, we need to educate people. And yeah. So clear the message.
Yeah, I think that education is, I mean, for us, if you sell prescription eyewear, really, really high fashion brands or own brand and complicated lenses, you need to trust, you need to build a brand yourself, right? And I think it all starts with the value proposition and the messaging. And we were obsessed in the beginning of trying to find out in what stage of the customer journey do we have to tell them what about the product that is just enough to do the next step, right? And then obviously it's smart media spending on top. I mean, I think even us have to spend a little bit of media, right? But it needs to be really targeted, and it starts with the message, I think.
What do you think?
Yeah, for us, 100% of people eat, so the market is there every day. Do I need a new recipe every day? Probably not. So we actually see two cases. One is the inspiration entertainment case, and the other one is the cooking case. So we are also on multiple platforms for inspiration, such as Facebook, Instagram, Pinterest. So really reminding our users of what they could do, and that Kitchen Stories is giving them a new recipe that they could try. But once we start cooking, we want to bring people back on Kitchen Stories, because you need features such as timer, shopping list, and a seamless consumer journey along the whole cooking process. So definitely, it's a really crowded market. Everybody is offering recipes. And when we started the company, actually exactly 5 years ago, everybody was like, we don't need another recipe app. There's so many out there. And we said, well, but they are all bad. Like, it's all bringing like a cookbook online. It's like an ebook PDF kind of style, and nobody is doing something around video. So we really focused on the product. And for example, we are reaching more than 16 million downloads all around the world. Wow. And we haven't spent a single cent on marketing yet. It's just because people love to use the product.
So how is it? Word of mouth? People just share it? How do people actually find the app and download the app?
Yeah, so initially we got discovered by Apple. So Apple featured us as one of the best apps. And then people started using it, started recommending it, giving it 5-star ratings on the App Store, and so it all kind of spread around. And then Google joined the whole mission, and now we're more than an app, and it's actually tough to build traffic online. So now we launched a website last year, and trying, and we also discussed a little bit about email and the old measures that we're now trying to get hold of.
It's funny, you started from the hard part, which is the app, and now you're going to the website. Do you know Dollar Shave Club? It's like, you know, your subscription to shave your face. So, you know, they got acquired by Unilever for $1 billion or so, and they were able to beat, you know, Gillette, which is like, I think, $50 billion company in their own world, in their comfort zone. They were able to create a better product, perhaps affordable product for sure, and a very cool story from a founder, why you should use this versus anything else. What do you think of, do you think big brands are becoming just irrelevant, slow, can't innovate? What happened there? Why can't P&G, which is not a horrible company, why can't they move as fast or pick up on a trend such as Dollar Shave Club?
I think brands have got to focus on the laws of attraction with their product. Whatever you sell, you're attracted to it for a reason. And I think, to me, bigger brands don't really focus on that too much. Even Apple sort of changing the way that it looks. I used to be a very big advocate of Apple with the very clean lines. I don't like all the rads that are now blending it in to be like every other phone. So for me, it's about the laws of attraction, making whatever you sell attractive so that people buy it.
It's also, I think, no, go ahead.
It's also the way to think about innovation. I don't know. I feel like all the big companies, they're now starting incubators, accelerators. They are flying to Silicon Valley. They are coming back wearing sneakers, and they want to bring the next big idea back to the table. And I think you just need to have that mindset of also like trying something and giving it a moonshot and not being too concerned about if it goes wrong. And as you said, it's all around turnover and making more profit, but it's thinking about now and not too much about the future. That's why I also believe as a large company, you don't need to do everything on your own. You can also partner up or invest in startups because I don't really see a lot of the large companies really, really, really innovating, or it's bringing them a really hard time.
I mean, it's a bit pathetic when a large company has a person that's called head of innovation. So the only way to never innovate is to hire someone named head of innovation. that's to make sure you never move anywhere. So, I mean, I don't know how much I subscribe to the incubation concept. I mean, I know people do it, but I think someone just has to do it to be able to write a blog post on the corporate site and say we're innovating. But I do think that it makes sense to invest and partner strategically and, you know, find new ways to do things. Mirko, what do you think?
You know, I think also the situation is fundamentally different, right? If you are a manager in a large corporation, you got a large department, you got lots of stuff and legacy, right, that you are in charge of. So when you wake up in the morning, you say, okay, how can I make this thing profitable, right? And that's what you do 80% of the time, and 20% of the time you might think, well, how can I do something radically new? Yeah. Well, if you don't have anything, when you get up in the morning, you think 100% of the time, what can I do radically new, right? And it's just a completely different mindset. And then the other thing is, I think there is a consumer trend towards local and brands that I understand and where they're coming from and whatever. And I think that is a consumer trend that is also hard for the incumbents to play, right?
That makes. Even on the way here, you know, Mirko was asking me, "Do you know a company that can help us create many creatives and sort of so that we can see what works and what's not and fail fast?" Yeah. And most of the time, you don't hear a big company asking, how can we fail fast, which is a different mindset. So, Davies, I want to switch gears and talk about emotions. Yeah. I'm an emotional person, so I have an emotional question. You know, my dad is a musician, so I'm very passionate about Davies' company. So that's why I'm starting with you when I speak about emotions. So, you know, we all had this moment. You go to Best Buy or whatever store you go to. There's that wall with all the cool gear. You know, there's like a big screen. There's like a lot of headphones, big headphones, small headphones, tiny headphones. And then you put it on your head, and you switch through some songs, and you choose a really good song that you think will really emphasize whether these are good headphones for me to purchase or not. Like, does it sound amazing? How can you replicate or even create a better experience through online advertising without me ever actually trying the product?
It's difficult with sound. It's sound is invisible. So, and there's no way of measuring sound quality. So the reason how I started to develop it was at a particle level. I pushed my brain to understand how the particles were vibrating inside of our products and design and develop technology based around that process. And that's what I'm now training my engineers. But how we market that is really difficult, because if you just say, hey, we think at a particle level, then people are not going to buy your stuff. They're going to think you're crazy. But it's all about really the experience and getting real artists, real engineers, real producers to back our products. We don't pay for any endorsements. We don't have vloggers. We don't have any kind of endorsements that's paid. Nor do we just send out free product to people who have got followers. It doesn't work. People buy real, okay? People want to be sold something real. They don't want to be sold a dream that doesn't work. And so for us, we have Jimmy Page, Tony Visconti, Jarvis Cocker, Fran from Travis, loads of different artists endorse our product, and they keep mentioning it on their social feed, and they keep pushing it because they love what we're doing.
Are your clients young?
They're all ages.
All ages?
All ages. The effects that you have when you listen to our earphones is shocking. You put them in your ears, and people who say, oh, I can't tell the difference, it's because they haven't heard it. And when they hear it, they go, oh my God, I was never into audio, and now this just is intoxicating. It's a bit like VR. So it's a bit like Sonic VR.
I'm going to try them later on. I mean,
I've got a set so I can demo you.
Mirko, when I buy headphones and I don't like it, sucks, I wasted money, but it just doesn't sound what I expected it to sound. But when I buy glasses and it's not what I expected, I look ugly. And I never want to look less than amazing. So how do you deal with fear? Like, I'm afraid of looking not amazing.
Yeah, that's fear is actually unfortunately an important emotion in the buying process of prescription glasses. If you ask consumers, in this case, German consumers, two-thirds do not enjoy buying eyewear. And one part is that they're so afraid that either the lenses aren't good or the price is too high or they don't look good, right? In the beginning, and that was like 10 years ago, and we pretty fast implemented augmented reality. I think we were some of the first ones who used it. So you can just, use a webcam and have it applied to your face, or you upload a picture and try that on, because it's so important to see yourself with the frame. And the next thing that we then developed was the home trial, right? To just say, okay, if you still want to have it on your nose physically, we just ship 4 or 8 or 12 or whatever to your home for free. You try them out, and then you send them back. Because at some point in time, you might, there are people who want to have that physical thing, but that's how we do it. I mean, you need to see yourself, right? And we have a hotline. You can call opticians or whatever and just ask, do I look good? And they're going to tell probably...
And they tell you the truth.
They tell you the truth. They tell you the truth to your face.
Verena, I asked you before this panel if you fight the company I love the most, Google, YouTube. That's me being sarcastic. Yeah. But you said you're not fighting YouTube. YouTube is not your biggest competition.
Yes.
Why not?
because we believe that you're not cooking on YouTube. You can watch any video on YouTube, but it's not a good user experience. I don't do stop and play and pause, and the recipe is part of the description. It doesn't make sense, so YouTube is not our largest competitor. And if I think about a large competitor, there are so many people in the food space, like FMCG, retail, appliance, cookware. Everybody has recipes. Then there's the large platforms such as Pinterest, you mentioned YouTube,
right.
But the combination of video and usability is something on a global scale that we are not seeing in the market, and that's why I can't really have that number one competitor to beat.
When it says 8 minutes, does it mean 8 minutes to the end of the panel or 8 minutes till it's 5 minutes? Do you know the answer? You know? Yeah? All right. So I call the next section money, money, money. So you guys are big spenders, not you, but you will become a big spender. Maybe, I don't know, maybe. It's a way to bootstrap your, you know, to continue to, you know, discover more consumers. So as you're making a lot of, you know, probably you make a lot of great decisions versus other brands that are just buying banners or stuff. You're very good with like ROI and like making sure every dollar well spent. And that's why you're here today at DMEXCO. So if you can give, you know, for people here in the audience that would love to take your money, what advice would you give them? Like, what do you measure? What success looks like? When you give someone money and say, get me clients, what do you want them to do so you think they're an awesome channel for you?
CPA is the first one, or DR marketing. We obviously focus primarily on DR marketing. So CPA is very important. The second factor is CPM. We want to make sure that our we're getting enough impressions out there to keep the brand building. I create a full digital funnel from reach to traffic to view to add to basket and to conversion campaigns, then remarketing campaigns and lookalike campaigns.
So you do invest in awareness?
Yeah, totally invest in awareness. What is really interesting is the way that algorithms work. All algorithms, especially if you've got code on your website, see traffic coming through your website, so they learn who's buying and who's not, and who's viewing and who's pondering. So for us, we want to send in traffic from all sources, sort of holistic approach, so that all the algorithms get as much information as possible about the world. Because we're selling to 152 countries, and we sell worldwide, and we advertise worldwide. Sure. We also keep our messages very descriptive in their image size. So it's a lifestyle type of creative that shows what the product is. So
like storytelling and stuff. Mirko, how about you?
It's a dangerous question because we're passionate about marketing, so I don't know where to end or where to start. But so on the one level, I think, yes, customer acquisition cost and customer lifetime value, you need to measure, right? You need to know how much value, how much is your customer valued, and how you can increase this, and you need to know how much you pay for a new customer. Okay, that's on the one level. The other, how do you do it? I think the second rule is you need to measure both. You need to measure media spend, and you need to measure creative impact, right? Because if you don't know if your creative is good, you don't know if your media spend is as well spent. So, and I think, and when it comes to those creatives, it ties into the brand. We all want to build a brand that people recognize us and love us for what we do. And a brand has so many facets, right? You have benefits that people should think of, and you have a tonality and a personality and whatever. But all of that you can define and measure. And I think at one point in time, you need to do both. You need to measure your media spend really well, but you need to measure if you're getting that message across that you want to get across, right? And if it helps you sell product or if it doesn't help you sell product. So that's what we do. We measure on all different levels, right? We measure all the brand values and our brand performance, and we measure our media spend performance.
I didn't know you were spending money on brands. Verena, you're a very global company.
Yes.
If you can give us a quick advice or like something that you've learned or anything for someone here that wants to become global, what do they need to know?
Well, first of all, what we learned is that the same content can work around the world. So for example, in China, people are making the same dishes, the Western dishes, than in Germany or the US. And via digital platforms such as the Apple App Store, Google Play, etc., you can be global within like one click. And that's the beauty of being or starting a company these days and not having to ship a physical product. So think global and try it out. So for example, we started in German and English because we speak German and English, and our videos don't really have a voiceover, so we just translated it. Right. And then in the next step, we just chose 10 more languages, such as Chinese, Spanish, French, Italian, and we just translated 150 recipes in order to see if people in Russia or China would also cook it.
Any mistake that you've done that you would have done differently?
All the time.
Give me one.
Give me one. One mistake that I've done or that we've done. I don't know. That's a tough one.
You want to think about it? I can get back to it.
Yeah, let me think about it.
So more, this is like really quick. What's your number one sold product? Headphones, glasses, recipe?
Manhattan cheesecake.
Manhattan cheesecake?
Yes.
Damn it. You?
it's actually a private label from Mr. Spex, a pair of Mr. Spex glasses, and then comes Ray-Ban, which is a good brand in a way.
Ray-Ban is there?
it's probably still the Aviator.
Okay.
Earplugs and ear protectors. We developed them for pro audio. Everybody else was using foam. I realized that titanium can block sound, and that ignited the snoring market. So we have lots of married couples around the world buying our ear protectors for sleep, which I'm not going to moan about because it's giving us a platform and a revenue stream to be able to grow.
I have three questions, and I don't know if the 1 minute is... So Mirko, this is about investors. So, when I started Taboola, I met many, 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 many investors, and the majority of them said never will invest in you. And the reason they said you don't deserve our money is because publishers will never recommend other publishers' content. That was exactly 11 years ago, so I'm by far the oldest. But now we're 1,000 people a company with $1 billion in revenue. I can only imagine, Mirko, that when you talk to investors and tell them people will buy glasses online and retail stores will be part of the history, they'll say that it will never happen. So what do you tell them when they say never?
Well, if they really say never, then they're probably not going to give you the money. But it's just time changes. There's progress every individual second and minute in the world, right? And if you don't believe in progress, and if you don't at least have an open mind and heart to think about new ideas, right? You're probably wrong as an investor.
So who's a good investor? Who is a good investor?
Long-term greedy. Me.
Yeah. A good investor, there's all this talk about smart money, and I think it's actually right. I mean, obviously you want to have an investor who goes all the way, ideally, but even better is an investor who goes all the way, who knows what you're doing.
I mean, I'm sure you've experienced, Verena, like cooking is such a complicated, mature, competitive market. How did you raise money?
We didn't, because nobody wanted to invest in us.
So you've never raised money?
Now we have, but in the beginning, we sold our cars, friends, family, fools, and we just rented an Airbnb place and started with 100 videos that we shot.
It's amazing how when you're successful, people suddenly really believe in your vision. What about you, Davies?
For me, I had a first round investors who only wanted to put a small amount of money in, and then the company struggled for quite some time, because for me, it's been 5 years of hell to get to a couple of years ago. And then a couple of years ago, we found some long-term investors who are long-term.
It's the end. The end. You said once there's music, there are a few more minutes, just so you know. Fake news.
But long-term.
Ladies and gentlemen, the one and only Adam Signola. Please give a big hand. Mirko Caspar, David Roberts, Verena Hubertz. Thank you very much. Thank you for a great panel. Thank you. You have to leave the stage now.